what needs to be an ongoing commitment for us and for people of faith, and a commitment that feels like it's been lost this week. We say the words so that the vision is not lost. So Jesus is talking to his disciples. He's telling the story. The story is about a king who's speaking to some followers. The king says, "I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you gave me clothing. I was sick and you took care of me. I was in prison and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and we visited you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these, you did it to me." You did it to me. Amen. Blessed be. Once again, welcome. We're going to sing. The opening song is called "For a World Made Whole." I believe you have the lyrics in your order of service. Lyrics will also be on the screen. This is a song that Mary and I wrote a number of years ago. We've done it a few times. She'll play it through once, and I'll start singing. It's pretty easy. You'll catch on. Please rise as you are able. Rise in body or in spirit. Seated.
So in your program, it says time for all ages. And I think those of you who've been around for a little while know that when it's time for all ages, we typically invite the children to come forward and have a conversation with me or hear a story. Well, I'm not actually going to do that today. I'm going to invite the children and young people to stay with their families. What I wanted to do is talk about what for me has become a very important spiritual practice, especially in difficult times and hard times and challenging times. And many of you have heard me say these words before. Anything good you've ever been given is yours forever. Anything good you've ever been given is yours forever. So this language comes from one of my favorite spiritual writers, who I quote often from the pulpit, Rachel Naomi Remen. It's Dr. Remen. She's a medical doctor, and she describes herself as a psycho-oncologist, which means she does talk therapy with people who are living with cancer, primarily. I think she's retired now. She's also a spiritual writer, and she's a speaker. And her first book, which came out in the 1990s, was called Kitchen Table Wisdom. And throughout that book, she tells stories about her grandfather, who was an Orthodox rabbi. And she loved her grandfather, and she learned a lot from him as a young child, age 4, age 5, age 6. He used to bring her into his study, and he would teach her Jewish wisdom. And sometimes she remembers she didn't really want to learn. She didn't want to sit there and try to memorize some of these phrases from the Torah and from the Jewish wisdom literature. And on those times when she didn't want to learn, he would, as she says, ply her with Manischewitz Concord grape wine, which he had in his office for the Jewish Seder. And she liked the wine. She remembers as a little kid it was sweet and she liked it. So now, when she's many years older and she's in the grocery store and she walks by a bottle of Manischewitz wine, many years after her grandfather has died, she gets choked up. She gets teary because she's thinking of the lessons of her grandfather. And she says, it's the last line of the book, anything good you've ever been given is yours forever. So what I wanna do is invite you just for a moment to sit in silence. And I want you to contemplate the good things you've been given. And I do think this is an important spiritual practice for times that don't feel good, just to bring goodness into your lives. So the kids, everyone, what are some of the good things you've been given? Now, I don't know if the people at home, well, I'm gonna invite Mary to play a little bit for about a minute as you contemplate. I don't know if we have the microphone on the piano, but we'll have it, the piano here in the room. Go ahead, Mary. If anybody would like to just name briefly something that came to you in that moment of contemplation, just raise your hand, I'll bring a mic. If any of the kids want to come up and come up and talk to me right here and tell me, you're welcome to run up and we'll give you the microphone. Here, pass that to Alan.
I don't want to leave you hanging. I was given two parents which were very kind and helpful. And despite when I was being belligerent, they still stood by me and loved me.
Thank you. Ellen?
I was given music, which has helped me throughout my life when I was young.
Some music parents. I'm going to go over here to David.
Well, certainly family members, but I think as an adult, I would say friends, especially.
Friends, maybe one more. I see Jim.
Two words, love as a verb and sin as a miss.
Thank you. Are you raising your hand, Lucy? Okay. All right. Did I say Jim last word? No. If I did, I lied. We'll give it to Susan.
Well, besides wonderful people in my life, my parents, my husband, my sweetie, this congregation.
Thank you. So we're going to send the children to their classes with this message. Anything good you've ever been given is yours forever. And as the children depart, we're going to sing. The song is How Could Anyone? I think it's number 1053 in the blue book. Am I right about that? Yes. And it is, words will be on the screen. I invite you to remain seated and we'll sing it through twice. It's short.
Could anyone ever tell you you were anything less than beautiful? How could anyone ever tell you you were less than whole? How could anyone fail to notice that your loving is a miracle? How deep you're connected to my soul. How could anyone ever tell you you were anything less than beautiful? How could anyone ever tell you you were less than? Your loving is a miracle. How deeply you're connected to my soul.
All right, friends, it's the time in our service for the sharing of joys and concerns and introductions. This is a special and sacred time we share every Sunday morning. It's a time when we have the opportunity to learn what is on each other's hearts and minds. It's a time when we may know and be known, hold and be held, love and be loved. Nick will light candles for anyone who wants a candle lit. Those of you at home, if you want to put a joy or concern or introduction in the chat, we'll read it in a moment. Friends, if you've got a joy or concern you wish to share with this beloved community, please come forward. I usually make a line over here. And I just remind us of the one or two sentence rule. Our lives go on, even in the midst of hard times, our lives go on. Come on up, Susan. Sunday morning. How precious it is through a ritual such as this to learn what is on each other's hearts and minds, to hold each other in our times of sorrow and grief and challenge and struggle,
and vulnerability, and to smile and clap and cheer for each other in our times of joy and success. How precious it is to be reminded that each of our lives tells a story worth knowing, that each of our lives harbors deep and abiding truths, that each of our lives is sacred. And then to know by extension, to know, to trust, to believe, all life is sacred. All life is sacred. Amen and blessed be. Mary will bring a brief musical response. Thank you, Mary. Friends, we're going to take our offering. I remind us our congregation is supported by the very truly generous financial giving of members and friends through the course of the congregational year. We also take a weekly offering and we dedicate approximately half of that offering to local organizations whose work helps strengthen the area safety net or advance important causes and initiatives. For the month of November, the recipient of this community outreach offering is Manchester's Senior Adult and Family Services Office. I know that the gift that we give goes to support seniors and families who are experiencing food insecurity. And I know your donation is deeply, deeply appreciated. For our offering music, this is a first. This is Eric Rosenberg's debut in this congregation, O Mio Bambino Caro, by the composer Puccini. I heard Eric playing this, I don't know, it might have even been last week. It was a couple weeks ago. And I thought, oh, we have to have this on Sunday morning. And so here we are. Thank you. So thank you, Eric. Thank you, Mary. It is beautiful. It's a beautiful piece. So, friends, after last Sunday's service and sermon, a far greater than usual number of you called, wrote, or texted to thank me for my words and to say you felt better, felt not so alone, felt more hopeful. I hadn't anticipated that response, although maybe I should have. And it was gratifying to hear from so many that my words had been well received and were helpful. This morning is different. This morning is different. The election is over. Donald Trump won the presidency handily. Though I do hope that being here in the UUSC sanctuary or in our online space together will remind you you are not alone. I also confess I don't really know what to say to make anyone feel better or more hopeful about the future of the United States or about your own future or about the futures of your families, your loved ones, your friends. Like many of you, I have been struggling emotionally. I've been cycling through fear, sadness, anger and rage, disbelief, disgust, and all the shades of feeling in between. Like many of you, I've been struggling physically. I've been sick to my stomach at times. I've been dizzy and jittery. I've been not sleeping well and therefore tired. I will say this, I have not lost my appetite, but some of you report that you really don't feel like eating. Like many of you, I've been struggling spiritually, not feeling grounded, not feeling rooted, not feeling centered, not able to take the full breaths I know I need to take. Perhaps if you leave this place this morning and remember nothing else that I say, remember the admonition to breathe. We always start with breathing. I said last Sunday that in the very least we could anticipate the next few weeks would be very hard, meaning that if Kamala Harris won, there would be relentless legal challenges, disinformation campaigns, and possible violence. Now we know it's not just the next few weeks that will be difficult. Now we know it's minimally the next 4 years and likely beyond that that will be difficult. And of course, the word difficult does not begin to articulate what is likely coming. Given what the president and vice president-elect have promised, what the writers of Project 2025 have promised, what anti-immigration radicals like Stephen Miller have promised, what Christian nationalist leaders have promised, what Elon Musk has promised, given all that, referring to it simply as difficult feels somehow to wildly miss the mark. Furthermore, we must be mindful that what those of us with more resources and more privilege and more financial security experience as difficult will likely be catastrophic for those on society's margins. So I've landed on five things that I want to say to you. And my caveat before I share them is that everything I have to say ought to sound familiar to you. There's nothing new here, certainly nothing radically new. What is new is the shift in the American body politic that has brought Donald Trump to the presidency, claiming a popular mandate, meaning he won the popular vote. What is also new is the lack of guardrails, the friendlier courts, the supportive legislature, giving him far more unbridled power this time around. So given that newness, what I have to say, though I have said it before, feels to me more radical, more essential, more vital, and I hope it does to you as well. The first thing I want to say is that the depth of our spiritual life and practices, our individual spiritual life and practices and our collective spiritual life and practices, that depth matters immensely. Our capacity to move through the coming years with strength, resilience, grace, hope, and an abiding love depends first and foremost on the depth of our spiritual life and practices. So I say, make it your righteous habit to breathe deeply. In and out, in and out, in and out. Take time to breathe every day. Breathe in peace, as the song says. Breathe out love, as the song says. Breathe in peace. Breathe out love. Then pray. And I know many of you do not consider yourself to be praying people. That has to change. And this is what I mean. Whether you are a committed atheist or a committed theist or anything in between, I say the words of your deepest longings out loud. Let yourself and those around you encounter in your words what your heart longs to say. Let your body and the bodies of those around you resonate with your voice as it speaks the words your heart longs to say. Let your spirit and the spirits of those around you soar in response to the words your heart longs to say. Then go outside. Bear witness to the natural world. Bear witness to the earth. Bear witness to the last falling leaves saying your name. Reach down in any way you can and touch the earth. If you can, lie down on the earth and stay there for a while and let this earth touch steady you. Let this earth touch ground you. Let this earth touch center you. Then stretch. Then walk. Then sing, then create, however you create. Do your journaling, meditate, read scripture, whatever is scripture to you. Exercise, sit quietly, sit in stillness. Then come to worship on Sunday morning or whenever you worship. Come to this sacred space or join us online. Come so that we can be together, because that is the center of our collective spiritual life. This being together in beloved spiritual community is our central spiritual practice. Don't give up on it. Come so that none of us has to face what is happening in our country alone. Come so that we can go through it together. Second, just as you did it to one of the least of these, so you did it to me. I have never been more clear in my life. We, the members and friends of this Unitarian Universalist congregation, we Unitarian Universalists across the United States and indeed across the world, and we liberal people of all faiths, all religions, must root ourselves in solidarity with the least of these. We must proudly, unapologetically, and faithfully align ourselves with oppressed peoples, with poor people, with, as the biblical reading says, those who are hungry and thirsty, those who are strangers in need of welcome, those who are naked in need of clothing, those who are sick or in prison and in need of visiting. We must proudly, unapologetically, and faithfully orient ourselves to the needs, the vision, the organizing efforts, the strategies of those who are targeted by this incoming administration, people targeted for deportation, people targeted to have their hard-won rights taken away, targeted to have public goods and services taken away, targeted to have their history erased, targeted to have control of their own bodies taken away. We must proudly, unapologetically, and faithfully align ourselves with freedom and justice movements led by women, led by Black, Indigenous, and people of color, led by immigrants, led by transgender, non-binary, and queer people, led by people with disabilities. We must proudly, unapologetically, and faithfully pursue a vision of earth justice, earth stewardship, and earth survival. I have never been more clear. And what I'm also clear about is we know how to do this. We know how to do this. A few years before I arrived as your minister, this congregation voted overwhelmingly to become a Unitarian Universalist Association, welcoming congregation, and to support and empower gay, lesbian, bisexual, and transgender people, both here and in the wider community. And we have done that. For us, this is not just a proud legacy. This is a fundamental spiritual commitment. And soon after I arrived in this congregation, we became a certified Unitarian Universalist Association Green Sanctuary. It means a lot of things, but the way I put it in shorthand is we are dedicated to living in harmony with the earth. For us, this is not just a proud legacy. This is a fundamental spiritual commitment. In more recent years, we overwhelmingly passed a congregational resolution in support of the Black Lives Matter movement. And still more recently, we overwhelmingly passed a congregational resolution to become a sanctuary congregation. For us, these are not merely proud legacies. They are fundamental spiritual commitments. They have never been easy commitments to keep. Never. But we have made them, and in the weeks, months, and years ahead, I have no doubt we will be called to fulfill them in ways we never imagined when we first made them, meaning it's time to grow and stretch and expand. Third, and this one feels the hardest to talk about, struggle lies ahead. I use the word struggle a lot without really clarifying what I mean. The struggle for social justice, the struggle for racial justice, the struggle for reproductive justice, the struggle for worker justice, the struggle for environmental justice, the struggle for justice for GBLTQIA people. None of these struggles are new, but Tuesday's election results have catapulted the stakes into the stratosphere. So when I use that word struggle, I sort of assume that everybody knows what I mean. And sometimes I worry that I and we have entered into these struggles. We have faithfully entered into these struggles, but we've entered into them in ways that require the least amount of disruption in our lives, the least amount of sacrifice, the least amount of risk for us. And to the extent that's true, my gut tells me the era of safe struggle is over. Although we don't know yet what struggle looks like in the coming months and years, I'm confident it will be different. I'm confident it will require more from us than we are accustomed to. I'm confident it will require sacrifice, and I'm confident it will be disruptive. I'm trying to imagine, this is just one example. Some of you may have already tried to imagine this. I'm trying to imagine multiple families facing deportation living in this building. I'm trying to imagine it. It doesn't seem possible, and yet that may be precisely what we are asked to do, and we will find a way. A few years ago, I preached a sermon entitled, "Perhaps Struggle is All We Have," and in that sermon, I shared wisdom from the writer Ta-Nehisi Coates' 2015 book, Between the World and Me. Those of you who remember that book remember that he wrote it as a letter to his then teenage son about the way the United States treats black bodies and how to live. It was guidance on how to live in such a cruel society. In that book, there's a passage that has become scripture to me. He says that justice is never guaranteed. Justice is never guaranteed. He said, this is a quote, "You must resist the common urge toward the comforting narrative of divine law, toward fairy tales that imply some irrepressible justice." Someone's got a phone. Someone's trying to talk to you. Is it you? I don't know. Maybe Sylvia, you could help. Because I think someone thinks you're in trouble, Hinda.
No, it's my daughter.
Okay. Justice is never guaranteed. So I take this, and in that sermon, I took it as a repudiation of that sentiment from Martin Luther King, that statement from Martin Luther King, which he developed from the 19th century Unitarian minister Theodore Parker. The moral arc, I'm going to wait till the phone stops beeping. Maybe, Sylvia, maybe you could take the phone and talk to the daughter and out in the room, just so she knows everything's okay. Sorry, friends at home, there's an interrupting phone. It's not the first time this has happened. It's happened before. You think you're good? So the quote from King is, "The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice." And what Coach is saying is, no, it does not. It's long, but it does not bend towards justice. That's a myth. And what he says in response is, perhaps struggle is all we have because the God of the universe is an atheist and nothing about this world is meant to be. So you must wake up every morning knowing that no promise is unbreakable, least of all the promise of waking up at all. Which sounds pretty grim, but then he says, this is not despair. Do not confuse this worldview with despair. These are the preferences of the universe itself. Verbs over nouns, actions over states, struggle over hope. So last Sunday, I spoke about the promise of the founders of the United States of America, the promise that they made to their posterity. This week, the hard lesson, no promise is unbreakable. But let us not despair. We can still act. We can commit to struggle for what is right and good. We can commit to struggle for the reassertion of the founder's promise. We can commit to struggle for the least of these. We can commit to struggle for democracy. Let us trust that struggle is indeed a preference of the universe. Let us make ourselves ready to be in the struggle. Fourth, despite the broken promise, I urge you to keep alive the dream in your heart. Last Sunday, we sang America the Beautiful. Many of you reported getting choked up in ways you didn't expect. I loved that. This week at our vigils and in private conversations, some of you reported feeling that the United States of America is done, is over, has failed, or more specifically, that American democracy is now dying, if not dead. And I don't want to in any way belittle or downplay the strength and intensity of your feelings if you feel that way, but I do want to urge you to keep alive the dream in your heart. I borrow this language from the 20th century American mystic and mentor to Martin Luther King Jr., the Reverend Howard Thurman. As long as we keep the dream alive in the heart, he says, we will not lose the significance of living. He writes, the dream in the heart is the outlet. It is one with the living water welling up from the very springs of our being, nourishing and sustaining all of life. The dream is the quiet persistence in the heart that enables us to ride out the storms of our churning experiences. It is the ever-recurring melody in the midst of the broken harmony and harsh discords of human conflict. It lives in the inward parts. It is deep within, where the issues of life and death are ultimately determined. Keep alive the dream, for as long as we have a dream in our hearts, we cannot lose the significance of living. Don't let this election kill your dream. However you understand the promise of the United States of America, however you understand the promise of our Unitarian Universalist faith, I urge you to keep alive the dream in your heart. And on those days when you simply can't keep it alive, please know and trust that I or someone in this congregation will keep it alive for you, just as I know and trust that on those days when I simply can't keep it alive, you will keep it alive for me. That's how it works in spiritual community. And along those lines, fifth and finally, please know and trust this too. I love you. I love you dearly. And I know you love me dearly. And I know you love each other dearly. And I know and trust that you love the promise of our nation just as you love the promise of our faith. And I am glad I have you. And I am glad we have each other. And I'm glad knowing that we will not go through this alone. I am glad, I am heartened, I am hopeful knowing that we will go through this together. Amen, and blessed be. Thank you. The hymn is "There Is More Love Somewhere." This comes out of the African American spiritual tradition. Words will be on the screen. It's also number 95 in the hymnal. I invite you to rise as you are able. And those of you at home, rise as you are able. Belt it out. Add your voices to our song. If you haven't done so already, I invite you to take the hand of someone nearby. If you are concerned about cold and flu season and COVID and all the other things that are out there, you always do this. Just put your hands on your shoulders. That is not offensive.
Tell them to leave the first four rows up.
Oh, yes. People in the first four rows, leave the first four rows up. I'm going to extinguish our chalice flame here in the sanctuary. If you've lit a flame at home, I invite you to extinguish it now. I have said these words every Sunday for years, but they seem so, so essential today. We extinguish our chalice flame, mindful that the flame in our heart, the flame at the heart of this, our beloved spiritual community, and indeed the flame of all our relations, is never truly extinguished. Words to our closing circle will be on the screen in just a moment. I invite you to say them along with me. May faith in the spirit of life and hope for the community of earth and love of the light in each other be ours now and in all the days to come. Friends, go in peace. Stay strong.